So I posted these slides already in our Google Classroom. So it's a spectrochemical measurement. So before we continue with our what we call the spectrochemical measurement, let us review what we have discussed last time. Okay, some types of this what we call optical interaction. So for instance, this one. Okay. So if we're going to look at these optical interactions that we have here, okay, so this is just what? If we're going to look at the interactions that we have here. So for instance, here in letter A, in the absence of an external radiation source, the analyte can be excited by collisional processes or chemical reaction, okay, resulting in what we call the emission or chemiluminescence being measured, okay? So we could say the first optical interaction. Come on, but ayaw mag-ano itong writing pad ko. Lobat na naman. So, pag lobat na siguro eh, hindi na siya nagsusulat. There you go. Yan. So if we're going to look at this, this is an example of chemiluminescence or emission. Okay? So in this case, what we have is your analyte can be excited by collisional processes. Tumatawag yung boss ko. Okay. Can be excited by collisional processes or chemiluminescence is what we call the measured. So this results in the emission or chemiluminescence. Now, on the other hand, both B, this one, and C, what do you observe here? Okay. There are, we could say, light source or radiation beam that is being directed into the sample. So in B, what happened? Okay, so the one that we have discussed before, so you can either have it bounce up like this, resulting in reflection, or the passage from one medium to another medium, which is what we call refraction. Okay? So that's another, we could say, optical interaction that we can observe. Now, with C, the radiation can be what? Okay? It can be scattered or produce photoluminescence. It can be absorbed. Okay? It can be transmitted. Okay? So all of this, we could say, just show us the typical optical interaction. Okay. Now, we can also review what we have learned so far based on this, what we call interaction. So what can you say about letter A? Anyone? If ever I put some questions about this, so what does this refer to? What can you say about letter A? What is that? What optical interaction does it happen? Anyone? Sa tingin niyo, anong optical interaction yung A? So there's a what? Absorption and energy, and then what? So the analyte is excited either by thermal, chemical, or other non-radiative process. That's why you have here the dashed line. So the analyte can return to the lower energy state by what? Ano sa tingin niyo?
Emission po, sir.
So this is an emission, or we could say a chemiluminescence. So this is just trying to show you the Jablonski diagram kung ano yung ano. Now how about the second one? What happened here? Okay, so the sample we could say is transmitted from a ground state to a higher state. So there is just what we call absorption. Do you follow that? Okay? And we're going to repeat all of them again today. Parang in detail kasi yung ano natin dito sa course na to. Okay, so here we could say absorption of a photon and the resulting reduction in intensity of the photon signal is measured in absorption techniques. Now in letter C, what do you see here? So there is an absorption and what follow? There's a dashed line. Okay. So we could say, what is this? Here, dashed line yung pataas, tapos straight line yung pababa. So how are we going to what we call differentiate this letter C from that of letter A?
Meron dun pong emission ng hindi light na energy dito sa letter C, sir.
Yep. So if you're going to look at letter C, there's an emission of a photon, okay, following radiative excitation. So we could say ang minimeasure talaga natin dito is specifically photoluminescence. Okay? So if you're going to look at this, what's happening at letter C, the emission of a photon following radiative excitation, term photoluminescence is measured to the dashed line, and the arrow indicated that the excited state can also lose its energy by a non-radiative pathway. Now, if you're going to look at D and E, what can you say about D and E? Ano yan? There are what? Excitation and then deactivation, so it can involve both radiative and non-radiative transition in which this, the wavelength of the emitted photons can be less or greater. So, alin dito yung stocks, alin dito yung anti-stocks? You still remember this? Both of them pertains to Raman. Okay, so one of them is a stock. And the other one is, we could say, the anti-stocks. Tapos yung F, okay, we could say it's also similar, okay, where the species undergoes a non-radiative deactivation to a lower excited level before photon emission happens. So that's just the summary of all the optical or common types of optical transition, okay? So the first one, we could say that's optical interaction. So this one has something to do with optical transition. Okay? And that brings us, okay, if you're going to look at the book, to the next chapter. Okay? So we have discussed already the chapter one of the book. Okay? So the one that we're going to discuss today has something to do with what we call spectrochemical measurement. Okay, so that's really the title of the chapter. So in the spectrochemical measurement, okay, we discuss about what we call the measurement. So ano bang ano natin sa measurement? How do we define measurement? Whenever we do measurement, do we do comparison? So whenever when we have what we call measurement, we can define it as the determination of a particular characteristic of a sample in terms of a number of standard units or of that characteristics. Okay, so we can have a chemical concentration measurement that consists of determining how many standard concentration units. So it could be molarity, okay, or other else. So usually when you do a measurement, okay, we compare it with what we call a standard. So ano pwedeng ibang name ng standard dito? A reference? Okay. So whenever we do a measurement, okay, we always compare it with a standard. Kaya nga, di ba, yung unit of measurement natin, kailangan natin standardize. Remember, during the early times, people use what? Parts of the body as unit of measurement. And we know we cannot do that because let's say you are trading with Shaquille O'Neal and one of the unit of your measurement is by foot. So you know literally a foot is the length of your what we call foot. And human beings, they have different length of foot. Okay? So may instances na malulugi ka, okay, kung hindi standardized yung unit of measurement that you use. So usually, spectrochemical measurement system differs from, let's say, electrochemical measurement or system in that during the measurement process, the chemical information is carried or encoded as an optical signal. So usually if it's a spectrochemical measurement, it is different, let's say, with electrochemical, because in a spectrochemical measurement, it sort of encodes in the form of the optical signal. Okay? So, if we're going to look at this chapter, we could consider first the different, okay, spectrochemical measurement process and identify the general component of the spectrochemical analysis system. So, these various ways in which the intensities of optical signals are expressed in the radiometric and photometric system in units are explored. So, we can have a quantitative determination of how concentration information is encoded. Okay? So, if we have a spectrochemical method, we classify them according to the types of spectral information produced and the principles of absorption, emission, luminescence, and scattering are going to be introduced. Okay? So, if we're going to have this spectrochemical determination or measurement, it involves many steps. Okay? And the steps that we have here are listed in this slide. So, the first thing that we have is the acquisition of the initial sample. Okay? So, if we're going to look at this, acquisition of the initial sample followed by sample prep or treatment to produce the analytical sample, and then the presentation of the analytical sample to the instrument, measurement of the optical signal, and then establishment of the calibration functions with standard and calculations, and then interpretation, and then feedback. So try to recall how you do spectrochemical measurement in your experience. So let's say, ano bang colored material that we can measure? So let's say you are asked to measure the iron content. in iron tablet. So how did you do the analysis following this step in the concentration of the analyte in the sample? So first, ano yung kailangan mo? Yung sample mo. Okay? The iron tablet. And then how are you going to do it? So maybe yung iron tablet nyo, what did you do? Dissolve it in an acid. So usually, what will happen? Okay? Your iron 2 plus can be available in its charge form. Okay? And then, what you do, you get the absorbance of it. Okay? So you put it in a cubette. So pwedeng itong parang test tube na cubette or the plastic cubette since it's colored. So once you get it, you're going to get the signal. Right? Now, how are you going to determine the concentration of the signal? What did you do? Anyone?
Pwede pong may standard curve na gawin, sir.
So you prepare different concentrations of the Fe2 plus. And then you do a calibration curve. And then from that, okay, so you get the reading. So maybe yung parang pagano na style. So you're going to put the reading of your sample there and then you interpret. And then you give the feedback. So usually that's how you're going to determine the concentration of the of the analyte in a sample. But this is using what? Absorption. Okay? So, if we're going to look at this in terms of a plot, so whatever I give you as an example can just be also interpreted by this one. Okay? So, what you have here, your sample is treated before the introduction. So, you have an analytical sample. It contains what? A certain concentration. Okay? And what happened there, since hindi mo naman maano agad kung ano yung sample, ilalagay mo agad doon sa cubette. Okay, if it's a solid, you have to make it into a liquid. Okay? So what you're going to do is you treat it before you introduce it doon sa sample holder. Now, the sample holder, it can be what? Manual or automatic. Okay? So once you have what we call the put it there, okay, you can get the measurement. So we have this called the spectrochemical encoder. Okay, now everything is controlled by what we call a system, and usually the control system it's operated by you. Okay. Medyo high tech nga lang ngayon. Noon is all the human being, but now you still need the what we call to be operated by you. So you introduce the sample, you get the signal. Okay, so the O1, O2, O3 there. So what happened there? Your system converts. I think I have it. So a sample introduction system presents the sample to the encoding system, which converts your concentration C1. C2, C3 to O1, O2, O3. Okay? And then the information selection system selects the desired optical signal. So, hindi lahat yan. Isa lang yung pipiliin mo. Okay? And out of this, the optical signal, it can be converted into what? An electrical signal. So, maybe you have a radiation transducer. So the radiation transducer is a device that will convert your optical signal into an electrical signal. So it could be I1, E1, or F1. So it could be what? A current, okay, a voltage, or a frequency. And this is processed and read out as a number. Di ba ganun naman lahat sa paggamit niyo ng instrument? I don't know. Try to think the time that you do some analysis using spectrochemical method. Maybe it is what we call absorption, UVBs, or fluorescence. But I think most of you limited yung experience in fluorescence. But if you do absorption, usually that's what you do. In Raman and IR, usually you do it like that. Pero yung information kasi doon mostly qualitative, not quantitative. Okay? So, if we're going to look at this, okay, this is just the spectrochemical measurement process. How the chemical concentration information is converted to a number, okay, by the process. So you have a sample introduction system that presents the sample to the encoding system that converts your concentration 1, 2, and 3 to optical signal 1, 2, and 3. And then you select only one of them, which is then presented to the optical information selector, okay? That is then what we call, well, the one that you selected, you put it in a transducer that will convert it into an electrical signal. So yung electrical signal mo, it can be frequency, current, or electron volt, okay? And then from that, what will happen is process and read out as a number. So ito yung kailangan natin, how the concentration can be translated into a number. Okay? Now, if you're going to look at the expression of the optical intensity, we can say there are two systems. One that is radiometric, and the other one that is what we call photometric. Have you heard this term before?
Yung photometric lang po, sir.
In photometric. So we could say these are two different approach in measuring light. Okay? Radiometric and we could say photometric, these are two different approaches to measuring light, and each of them serve specific purposes. Okay? So in what way they are what we call the same, or in what way they are different? So let's look at each of them. So when we're talking about this radiometric system, okay, what we have here is an approach where the radiometric unit is based on the actual radiant energy emitted, okay, by a source or striking a receiver if you have this optical transducer and preferred in the international system unit. So between the two, we could say one, the radiometric system is the one that is preferred, okay? And usually the basic unit that we have here is the radiant energy in joules. Okay, so the radiant energy that we have in what we call in joules. And these are just some of these general quantity that used to describe radiation sources and radiation receiver. So if I'm not mistaken, there's a table here that discuss all these radiometric systems. Okay? So you have what? Radiant intensity, emittance, emissivity, and radiance. So this refers specifically to radiation from a source, volume, area, and solid angles. So it refers to the properties related to the source. Now we can also have irradiance and exposure. So this describes the receiver and its area. Now you might be surprised, wow. So there are still many terms, okay, in terms of measurements of light. So if you're going to look at the quantity here, okay, those that involve this radiometric system So in general, you can put it as what? Radiant energy. And the description that you have there is the energy in the form of the radiation. And the unit that you have there is joules. And then you have radiant energy density. So it's just what? The radiant energy per unit volume. Parang density, mass per volume. But here, we describe it as energy per unit volume. That's why it's joules per cubic centimeter. And then you have the radiant flux or the radiant power. Okay? So the description for this is the rate of transfer of radiant energy. So the unit, what is the unit of this? Anong tawag dyan? The what? The one that we use in what? Saan natin ginagamit yung unit na what? Usually in, is it light bulb? Right? Okay? And then we have also what? In terms of the source. Okay? So if we're going to look at this radiometric system, we could say this is radiometry, which deals with the measurement of all aspects of electromagnetic radiation, including the entire range of wavelengths from UV to the infrared. Okay? So the source has something to do with the radiant intensity. So you have the I. Okay? So the radiant power per unit solid angle from a point source. So what per, okay, the point source here. And then you have radiant emittance or radiant excitance. So this is the radiant power per unit area. So what per square centimeter. And then we have emissivity. The radiant emissivity, the radiant power per unit solid angle per unit volume. So that equals to what per source per cubic centimeter. And then we have the radiant. So this is the radiant power per unit solid angle per unit projected area. Okay? And then we have the receiver. So we have the source then as a receiver. So you can have the irradiance and the exposure. Okay, so the irradiance, that's what we call the radiant power per unit area. So that's watt per square meter. And then we have the radiant exposure, that's the integrated radiance. So you have the joules per square centimeter. So there's still a lot. This is just the radiometric system. Meron pang isa, yung photometric, what we call the approach. Okay? So if we're going to look at these all quantities here, all quantities are in general functions of what? Spectral position, wavelength, wave number, frequency, in that they are usually employed to represent magnitude or of the quantity over some spectral interval. Okay? Have you known this thing before? Because if you're going to look at the defining equation that we have here, look at them. I just tried to simplify everything, but you can still further go in each of them by what? Deriving the equation for each of this quantity in radiometric system. But I told you, I don't want to do what we call some calculation. Okay, so I just forgot that part of what we call the defining the equation. But just to let you know that two approaches that you have, radiometric and photometric, and within those two approaches, there's still a lot of quantity. Okay? But what you need to, in general, these values represent the cumulative magnitude of the quantity over the wavelength interval from 0 to lambda. And if the term total is employed as in total radiance, it implies that the radiance over the wavelength interval is from 0 to infinity. So generally, radiometric quantities are considered within small spectral intervals. Okay? So if we're going to look, for example, some of this, so the radiometric quantities per unit spectral interval and given a subscript for lambda for wavelength, now V for the frequency, and the other one form of V is the wave number. So this one would be in the form of this. Okay? So if you're going to look at the spectral radiance, so that has something to do with V with the wavelength. That's the radiance per unit wavelength interval per nanometer. So if you're going to look at this, so this is still what? Paano ba ano dito? Differentiate V of the wavelength over difference of this one. Unfortunately, I already forgot my math doing this. Now, if you want to look at the partial radiance, so this is just V with change in the wavelength. So radiance in the wavelength interval. So the difference between two wavelengths. And if you're going to, ano ba tawag dito? Integrate them. So you end up with this one. I think I only use this in discussing in Gen Chem yung tinatawag na integrated rate law. Okay? So spectral, partial, and if you have the total radiance, so that's just the radiance from a source related to spectral radiance. So here, your radiance is just equals to spectral radiance, the difference of what we call this wavelength. So it's from 0 to infinity. Now, the thing is, the sources that emit narrow spectral lines, typically half widths, less than 1 angstrom, are usually characterized by reporting the radiance of each line, which is the integrated spectral radiance over the total width of the line. And if you have a broadband source, they are normally characterized by its spectral radiance, because only part of its emitted spectral range is selected or observed as determined by wavelength selector. Okay. Now we can look at some geometric factors here. We can include the geometric factors of solid angle and projected area. So for instance, if you have a plane angle, okay, and one radian of angle is illustrated as like this one. So if you have one radian, that's the angle of the center of a circle that is that intercepts an arc equal in length to the radius. So that's the plane angle in comparison to a solid angle. So look at the difference between the two. So plane and a solid one. So a plane could be described by radian, an angle or a solid angle would be described by is the radian. So if you have a solid angle defined by the cone generated by a line that passes through the vortex O, okay, and a point move along the periphery of the surface. So once the radian is the solid angle at the center of a sphere of radius R that subtends an area of R squared units on the surface. So the area of the sphere, 4 pi R squared. So the number of the radian in the sphere is just equals to 4 times pi times R squared over R squared, or cancel yan, we have 4 times pi, 4 times 3.14. Or 12.57. Now, in most of these, we could say spectroscopic situation, one is eventually interested in the radiant power that is incident on a receptor. So consider, for example, a point source with dimensions that are small compared to the distance from the source to the receptor or projected area. So we could say the source could be characterized by the total radiant power that it emits in all directions. So in this case, it's more useful to use the radiant power per unit solid angle or radiant intensity, which is given as this. So you have, okay, your I equals to the radiant power over 4 times pi. Now, you can also have a source of significant area like this one. So this is the area that you viewed. So that's A prime 1. So that's the source of the projected area, A1. And then the receptor of the projected area. So you have receptor of the projected area. And D here is what? The distance between the two. So the radiant power here, incident on area 2 of the receptor is the source radiant times the area times the solid angle viewed the times area viewed. Or your radiant power here is equals to B times omega times A1 or B over A2 divided by B2 times A prime 1. I'm just trying to show you an example how you have this what we call example of radiometric quantity. Now, in terms of, we could say, human perception, radiometric measurements, they do not account for how the human eye perceives light. They provide a raw measure of the total energy. Okay. Now, let's go on the other approach, the photometric approach. So we could say the photometric approach is a relative system based on the apparent intensity of a source as viewed by the average bright adapted human eye. Okay, so it's a relevant system based on the apparent intensity of an audiovisual source as viewed by the average bright adapted human eye. So we could say photometric system has something to do with what? As one perceived by the human eye. It takes into account the sensitivity of the human eye to different wavelength with greater emphasis on the visible spectrum. Kasi yun yung nakikita natin, the colored one. Okay? So, if we're going to look at this, this is, we could say, the weighted human vision. Okay? We can have photometric measurements according to a spectral intensity of the human eye, with more weight given to the wavelength in the visible region. Okay? So if you're going to look at this photometric system, the quantities in the system have meaning only in the visible region. And the basic unit that we have here is what? The lumen. So we could say this is, measuring luminous intensity compared to the one in the radiometric is just measuring the radiant energy. So a source of one candela would emit one lumen for is the radiant. Okay. So So it is, we could say one lumen is defined in terms of the standard candle, which is called candela. So the luminous intensity from a candela is 1 over 60 of the luminous intensity of the black body radiation. So that should be one lumen per steradian, not lumen, okay? A source of one candela would emit one lumen per steradian. Okay, so if you're going to look at the photometric and the corresponding radiometric quantities, we are given here the table. So we could say this is a side-by-side comparison between a radiometric and photometric quantity. And we can define it in terms of the photometric quantity. So radiant energy, in terms of this photometric quantity, it's a luminous energy. It's the portion of radiant energy in the visible region. Radiant power or flux. So this is what? Luminous power or flux. So this is the luminous energy per unit time. And then you have radiant intensity. So you have here luminous intensity. So this is the luminous power per unit solid angle. So if you're going to look at this in terms of the what we call quantity, they're almost the same. The only one that differentiate them, one would use the word radiant and the other one would use the word luminous. Okay, and then we have emittance. So this is the luminous power per unit first area. And then this is the thing. Irradiance, illuminance, luminous power per unit area incident on our surface. And then we have the radiance, and then we have what? Luminance or brightness. The luminous power per unit, solid angle per unit projected area. So what can you say? Which do you think is the one commonly used? So based on, I'm going to summarize what I have discussed so far. If we're talking about radiometric stuff, okay, it's concerned with what? The total electromagnetic radiation. And if I talk about photometric stuff, it specifically account the way the human eye perceives light in the visible region. So parang mas specific yung photometric kaysa doon sa radiometric. Now you may ask yourself, which are the applicable one? Well, you have to look at the application. Where do you think radiometric approach used? So this is what? Everything that involves electromagnetic radiation. Absolute measurement of the radio electromagnetic radiation. So you can use it in astronomy. Remote sensing. And we could say heat transfer. Okay. Studies that involve astronomy, remote sensing, and heat transfer. Now, how about photometric? So usually you can use it in what? Photography, lighting design, or any field where the visual perception of light is essential and it provides a more accurate representation of how humans perceive light. Okay, so which is more advantageous? Well, it depends on the context and the specific application or requirements of the application. Okay, so I hope you learned something new about this one, about this photometric and radiometric approach in the spectrochemical measurement. Questions so far? Before we apply it in the spectrochemical method. Because I introduced to you how you do the spectrochemical measurement here. And then I discussed to you how the optical intensities are expressed. So what we're going to do now is look at the so-called spectrochemical measurement or method. Okay. So if you're going to look at here, how many do we have here? Five. And we look at it as how the quantity is measured. So we have what? Emission. So the way that we look here is the radiant power of those that are emitted. Okay, example here, flame emission, DC arc emission, spark emission. Now, the one that we have right now, ICP and DCP emission. Okay, and then we can also look at it in terms of what we call absorption. So this is just the absorbance or ratio of the radiant power transmitted to that incident. So we have here the UVBs, the IR, and the AAS. So if you're going to look at here, directly you need what? It's just like you put the radiation source there and see what happens. Okay. And then here in the luminescence, what do? You still need the radiation, but you're going to look at what will be the effect of that radiation on the sample, and you measure at the one that you see through the human eye, the luminescence. Okay. So the luminescence that we have, radiant power of luminescence, so that's the fluorescence and phosphorescence. You have the atomic fluorescence or chemiluminescence. Now, if you have the scattering, it's a radiant power that is scattered. So it has something to do with the Raman, turbidimetry, and nephelometry, as I discussed to you last time. And then you have also an indirect one. So here, this is, we could say, some other method that are indirectly due to spectrochemical stuff. The refractive index chain, so that's the basis of your RI detector in HPLC, one of the detectors that you have there to measure sugar. The acoustic waves, and then you have the ion current. So you have a thermal lensing, photoacoustic, and photo ionization. And what we're going to do is we're going to go to them one by one. Emission. Well, I'm too big. So if we have what we call emission, okay, so if we're going to look at this one, what's happening here, so this is what I showed you at the beginning. You have an energy, okay, that is added to your sample. So it could be thermal, electrical, or chemical energy, okay? So if you're going to look at this, okay, it causes what? Non-radiational excitation of the analyte and emission of radiation in all direction. So we could say, since it's in all direction, you have the term that they have is isotropic emission. So if you're going to look at this, what we call energy changes that you have here, it could give you what? The energy changes that occur during your excitation. This one, the dashed line. And then based on this, you have an emission. So your dashed line that you have here, that is, we could say, the excitation, the energy changes that occur. Okay? And then you have a solid line there. That's the emission as shown here in what we call B. And you have here the different energy states, 0, 1, 2. So depending on the difference of the energy change, you can look at the energy changes there between 2 and 1. So this is just, okay, HB 2, 1. Now here, this is just 2 to 0. So second energy level, HB 2. And then this one, just the first one, that is what we call HB 1. Now, this can be converted to what? The one that you see here. So, the wavelength 2 that we have here pertains to this. The second one that you have here pertains to this. And the H2 wavelength 2-1 pertains to this one. So, this is the result that you will get based on the transitions that you have here. So, this is the interaction. So you have energy there that is applied to your sample, and then what it do? It emitted radiation in all directions. So some of the transition that could happen here would be this one. And the typical spectrum that you have here is what? This. Everyone got that? Aray ko po. So what could be the example here? We can have a specific example here in terms of sodium in absorption emission spectroscopy. The sodium atoms, they're excited in a plane by collisional processes and they emit characteristic radiation. Now, if you're going to look specifically at what's happening here, the frequency of the emitted radiation corresponds to a discrete energy differences between levels as shown in the figures. This one. And when thermal equilibrium is maintained, the number of atoms per cubic centimeter in level I, that's Ni, is related to the total number of atoms per cubic centimeter, okay, Nt, by the Boltzmann distribution, which is this statistical factor of state I, Ni is just equals to, okay, the total number times G at level I times E raised to the energy at the initial level over K over T divided by C times the temperature partition function. So sodium and other alkali metals have excited levels close to the ground levels. Thus, the resonance lines occur in the visible and near IR planes and are readily observed in media such as planes. And if you're going to look at this, so you have here the radiant power of emission from state J to state I is given by the population density of excited atoms NJ times the probability of AJI. Okay, for a second, that an excited atom will undergo transition times the energy emitted photon times the volume element of observed volume. So we have it like this. So this equation shows that the radiant power of emission is proportional to the excited state population density and thus to the analyte concentration through the previous equation. So you want your sample here to be in the excited state, and the only way for you to do is you apply it with energy. And once it is an excited state, anything that is emitted, that's the one that you can measure. You got that? Or masyado ng deep? But that's how the emission happens. Now compare it with the next one. Absorption. So for the absorption to happen, okay, the frequency of the incident radiation must correspond to the energy difference between the two states involved in the transition, as shown here. So you have the incident radiation and the transmitted radiation. And usually what happened there, there's just absorption of light, right? So this is the energy that corresponds when there is absorption of light from this energy level to that energy level. And this is the energy that corresponds when there is absorption of light, okay, or radiation from this energy level to that energy level. So if we're going to look at here, okay, one would give you this peak and one would give you this peak. So the spectrum that you have is the one that you see in letter C. And if we're going to go farther, so maybe this is not new to you, right? So what is this? Anyone? What does A stand for here? Come on.
Absorbance.
Okay, so that's your absorbance. And this is your
transmittance, sir.
Transmittance. So if you're going to look at this, this is just the negative log of, okay, the transmitted radiation over the incident radiation. And we also know A here as what? This one I put here, that's really molar absorptivity. And then this one, what is B here? The path length. And C here, that is equal to your concentration. So this is not new to you. If I'm not mistaken, this has been discussed as early as what? Chem 32? Analytical chemistry? Or maybe Gen Chem 1? Now, which is a specific or constant value here for a specific compound or substance?
Absorptivity.
This one. Because once you know this, you can get a direct relationship between the absorbance and the concentration. Because your path length is always equals to what? 1 centimeter. Although if you're going to look at the path length, you will see that it is what we call related to absorbance. We have one experiment here where we vary the path length. You'll be surprised. But we have a cuvette that has this size and then this size, and then this size. So what do you think happened to the absorbance if you put the same solution in all of them?
Nag-increase yung absorbance.
So it increased because I'm telling you this because before I came here in the US, my concept is the path length is always what? 1 centimeter. But I experienced one experiment where the path length of the cubette increases or changes. Now, you might say that they're just from the same solution, so that means your concentration there would be the same, right? If you say, if you have one solution, or let's say you put all of them there, they just have the same concentration, right? But the difference that you have there is the path length. So there's an effect on the absorbance. I'm just trying to let you know or open your mind that the path length is not always 1 centimeter because that's the perception that I have before I came here in the US. Now, this is, we could say, the simplest among the four. Ito lang yung explanation niya, in comparison to the emission. Because the next one that we have is the luminescence. So this is the radiation emitted from relatively cool bodies. So if you're going to differentiate emission from luminescence, emission, you need what? Energy for it to emit, okay, some radiation. But luminescence, the radiations emit on its own. And you can have different classification of this, what we call luminescence. So when you have chemiluminescence and bioluminescence, they are produced by what? This one, a chemical reaction. Excited analyte species are produced, if it's chemiluminescence, chemical reaction. If it's bioluminescence, what it is? Biological reaction. Ano example nito? Maybe luminol?
Luminol.
Okay. How about the biological reaction?
Firefly.
Ba yun? Okay. Ano tawag doon? Alitap-tap? Firefly?
Apo.
Meron pa ba din dyan? We still see it here in the city. But not at this time, during summer. Okay. At this time, the fireflies, I think, are hibernating. So these are the one that is commonly used. Now, how about this electroluminescence? So where do you think this happened? So the root word there is electro. So it results from the movement of your electrons in a given sample and may be caused by electrical discharge, recombination of ions and electrons at us. Electrodes and by interaction of materials with accelerated electrons as in a cathode ray tube. So again, there's no energy. Okay, it's mostly movement of electrons. Now, how about this one? Triboluminescence. Is it the first time for you to hear the term? Never heard. So you'll be surprised. You think you already covered everything. Okay? So what could be the root word here? So when you have when you have tribal luminescence, this is the phenomenon where light is produced when certain materials are mechanically or physically stressed. Result from the mechanical separation of charges followed by a discharge. So when you have what we call this tribal luminescence, so it is produced when there's mechanically or physically stress like crushing, grinding, or breaking. And there's a release of light. And it's not due to heat, not due to energy, but rather as a result of the material undergoing a mechanical disruption. Okay? You know what the classic example here? Ang nakalista sa akin dito, broken crystals of sugar. You might think, paano nangyari yun? I'm trying to show you some examples. I don't know if you're familiar with this. Maybe ang familiar kayo dyan ay yung lifesavers, right? Meron ba ganyan sa'yo? Pinas? Sorry for the question. But I know lahat na meron dito sa US, meron na ngayon sa Pinas. Eh. Lahat ng food chain, meron na dyan. Are you familiar with that one? So meron question dito, why do green or green light savers spark in the dark? So all hard sugar-based candies emit some degree of light when you bite them. But most of the time, it's paint. So, kailan lang sila nag-emit ng light kapag they are under physical stress. I'm trying to see if there's some here, maybe here. Watch, slow mo. There. Kita nyo? You see it, class?
Yes, but
I hope it's play. Nawala. Ayun. Tribal luminescence slow motion. So first time yung narinig, pero pag may lightsabers kayo, wala namang sound. Ang gusto ko lang ay yung ano na agad. Yeah. Ah, inano nila yung under stress. See that light? Kita niyo yun? You see that? There's a blue color that came out. Although wala itong sound. But that is an example of what we call a triboluminescence. So maybe you learn another thing today. Now the last one, thermoluminescent. So thermoluminescence, this is, we could say, enhancement of other types of luminescence by addition of heat. Now, among these different type of thermoluminescence. Which do you think is the one that is being used? Okay, so thermoluminescence enhancement traditional with so some crystals when you put some what we call energy to it, okay, they trap some of the energy in their crystal lattice, and this energy trap can be released as a visible light when the material is subsequently heated. So in addition pa doon sa heat na ina-apply or energy na ina-apply, merong nare-release na luminescence. Now, in terms of this, what we call classes of luminescence, which do you think is the one that we use in analytical method? Usually, it's the first two, right? Especially the chemiluminescence. So chemiluminescence and bioluminescence, they are employed in analytical procedure. Now, how do they, what we call, explain in terms of their interaction, transition, and the spectra? So, if you're going to have this, what we call photoluminescence here, so this is a radiation-less process. Okay, so we have to emphasize here that there is no light that is applied there. Okay, a radiation-less process. So your sample there, okay, there might be some incident radiation or transmitted radiation that results to this what we call luminescence. But as I've told you, if you're going to look at this Jablonski diagram, so usually, if you're going to look at this, what you see here is not what? A straight down emission. Okay? So the way that you see it is, based on the Jablonski diagram, you have what? Energy level at the singlet state. Okay? So when it is excited, it doesn't go straight down. It passes through. Okay, some non-radiative processes, and then if it goes down in the singlet state, that's what? Fluorescence. If it passes through the triplet state, that's phosphorescence. Okay, so the methods that utilize an external radiation source for the excitation as mean absorption method, but the sought for information is the radiation emitted by the sample as shown here. Okay. So the one that is released here as a luminescence. So here, these are radiation-less process. Yang. And this has this what we call loss of energy by emission of photons. So based on this one, you're going to have a spectrum like the one seen here. So the excited species can dissipate excess energy by emission of a photon that is the luminescence, or by radiation-less process, the dashed line that you have there. Okay, so the emission of the usually is isotropic. Okay, and the frequency emitted corresponds to the energy differences between the levels that you have there. So this one is alpha 2 between here and this is alpha 1, this and this one, and then this one is this. And if you're going to look at this, you don't measure really the radiant power. What you have is the luminescent power. Okay, so the radiant power that you express it, that's really what we call the luminescence one. So when a portion of the incident radiant power is absorbed, so that the transmitted radiant power is less than the incident radiant power. Under many conditions, the radiant power luminesces for all wavelengths, and the radiant power luminescence is proportional to the absorbed radiant power. Thus, the radiant luminescence is equals to K times the difference of the initial and the final radiant power. And you can use here also what? The Beer's law. Okay? In terms of the radiant power equals to the initial radiant power times 10 raised to ABC. Or you can put it in terms of this, where K times the radiant power, the incident radiant, okay, that you have. And it always gives you to this expression. I think I'll end here because in the scattering, there will be different scattering that I'm going to discuss. And then by next meeting, you're going to be introduced to the different term like spectrograph, spectroscope, spectrometer, okay? Ano yung pagkakaiba ng mga terms na yun? So I hope you learned something today that you have not heard before, okay? Because that's really what this course is all about, okay? So question. So I will be posting the quiz today, the first one, and then by the weekend, the second one, because I have problem with Quilgo the last time. I'm going to use Quilgo, okay? I need to utilize the pre-Quilgo for February before we go to March, because there's only certain number of uses that I have per month for the free version. Yeah, I don't want to pay $16 per month again, like what I did in 233. So by next week, I'm going to start posting kung ano yung magiging ano ninyo. Tawag dito. Review article and reference or review paper or journal article that you're going to write. Okay, although some of you has already messaged me on what you're going to do. Okay, so question. So if none, happy weekend, Friday jan. Okay, and it's only Thursday here going to Friday, which is my heaviest day of the week. Okay, Monday and Wednesday is my hell day. So see you on Wednesday or Tuesday night here.